Hello there, I'm Florian and I will now tell you a little bit about encryption beyond encryption and signatures. For the start, we will look into what is cryptography, or just skim it at least. This is the Wikipedia definition of cryptography. It is the practice and study of techniques for secure communication in the presence of third parties called adversary. That's basically saying nothing. The most common thing that people think about when talking about encryption, about cryptography, is encryption. We look into two kinds of encryptions, mainly symmetric encryption and asymmetric encryption. Symmetric is where we already have a shared key. Asymmetric is where we don't, like the PGP signing party right now was for asymmetric encryptions. Then there are signatures, which should prevent tampering with documents, so to ensure that a document was created by someone who actually claims that he created it. And the nice thing for both of those problems, there are good solutions. And we will now look into some other problems and what we can do otherwise. The first one are commitments. This can be a very useful thing. Let's say Alice has some message that she wants to be able to prove at a later point to the public that she already knew it. And now she is able, or she wants to be able, to compute something that we will call a commitment that she can publish. But no one else should be able to extract any information about the information that she doesn't want to publish at that point. So this is what we call the hiding eigenschaft. It means that Bob cannot learn the message that Alice commits to. We also, however, want that it is binding, so that if Alice later on claims that she already knew this at the earlier point, that everyone believes her because she is not able to change what she committed to. This is the binding eigenschaft, binding property, sorry. And if you want to look into how these things work, I suggest you start with hash commitments. They are relatively simple to understand. You can also ask them as a question later on, but I would like to get through the slides relatively fast. And another important one are Patterson commitments. They're a little bit harder, but still on a level that lay people can understand if they are willing to look a little bit into group theory. So what can we do with that? Let's say Alice and Bob want to do a little bit of gambling. They need to compute a random value, and let's say they are not in the same room, so they cannot simply toss a die and hope that die is a fair one. But let's say they are just talking over the phone. And we usually start with a simple case and say they just want to compute one bit, so we call this a coin toss. And of course, they don't trust each other in this case, because if Alice can control the outcome, she will always pick the outcome that is favorable to her, and Bob will do the same. An example protocol for how this can work is the following one. And this uses commitments, which is one of the reasons, among others, that I just talked about then. Alice will throw a coin and send Bob a commitment for her result. So, and since commitments are hiding, Bob will not be able to learn the results, so he learns absolutely nothing from that. Bob then throws his own coin and will send the result to Alice, who will then open her commitment. This means that she will provide some information that allows Bob to verify. That means that Alice will send Bob her result, and she will also provide some information that allows Bob to verify that that was indeed what she committed to at an earlier point. And then they compute the XOR, and then they have a random bit if at least one of them actually picked his bit at random. And if they are both cheaters, they deserve whatever they get. A nice exercise for those who want will be here. This is a slightly changed version of the protocol. This is insecure. And if you want to see why cryptography is very hard, take a try at this one, why it is insecure. I leave that to you. Again, you can ask questions about these things in the Q&A if you want. Now, I was already asked about an explanation for zero knowledge proofs, and I think we'll start with something that might make this a little bit easier to understand. I need a volunteer. Yeah, okay, let's take the guy in the gray t-shirt. We can use mine. Come to the front. We will just use mine. We just need one mic. Now, what I haven't told you before is that I'm a mind reader. I can read numbers that people think. Now, our volunteer will should think of a number between 1 and 1,000. Have you thought of a number between 1 and 1,000?
Yes.
Okay. I think your number is 378. Is that correct?
Yes.
So, I have a 1 in 1,000 chance of doing that. But it's still a 1 in 1,000 chance that maybe I was just lucky. So, let's repeat it. Think of a number. I believe the number is 680.
Yes.
Okay, now I have a 1 in a million chance. Are you convinced that I can read minds? Unbelievers, I cannot fathom it, yeah. I just had a 1 in a million chance and I managed to get both right. So, and you still are not convinced. Should he at least be convinced? Yes, indeed. If you were here on the stage and you know that we were not cooperating, I would basically have had no chance of doing this. But of course we did what was the obvious thing I told him before, that he should just say yes. And this is the idea behind Zero Knowledge Proofs. You can sit down again, thank you very much. Please give him a one more round of applause. So, we call this a Zero Knowledge Proof. What does this mean? A proof in this case means I want to prove a statement. The statement was, I'm a mind reader. And the proof goes like this. I'm not actually proving the statement. I'm proving either the statement is true or I know your random values or your secrets. And if you're not cooperating with me and have no reason for me to believe that I know them, it's of course quite convincing if my chance is like 1 in 2 to the 128. However, if this was a true confirmation, no one of you believed that I could actually read minds. And the reason for this was that he could have just created a I could have just created a random transcript of this thing, and it would look exactly like a real one. There's no way to distinguish those. And this is where it's zero knowledge. The actual transcript cannot contain any kind of information that the parties that participate in it do not know up front. And since everyone can simulate something, we know it's true. And let's see what I have written down here elsewise. The second last statement is that this is that there are zero knowledge proofs for all NP complete problems or all NP problems. What this means in easier terms, for every problem where you have witnesses, if the answer is yes in case of decision problems, there is a zero knowledge proof like this. So you can prove basically everything that you care about in this way, which is pretty awesome, I think. And the example where I can see this is three-color zero knowledge proofs. These are, again, at a point where if you put a little bit of thought into it, they should be manageable for lay people to understand. Now, what else can we do in crypto? I mean, the topic of the talk is, of course, what else can we do in crypto? Let's look into secure multi-party computation. The motivating example here is usually the millionaires' problems. Let's say you have two filthy rich millionaires who want to know who of the two is richer. And they don't want to tell each other how rich they are, because then maybe the tax governmental offices might get wind of it and would find out that what they are doing is not very legal. So, but they still want to know who is richer, because that's basically their, you know what, measuring contest. And we are now looking into, can they solve this? And the answer is yes. And actually, we can do it in a much more general case. So the more general case shall be, both parties have some kind of secret. In the case of the millionaires, it was how rich they are. In other situations, it might be very, very different things, like, let's say, secret keys for encryptions or whatever. And then there shall be a function that allows to compute something that both parties are interested into if you put all the secret inputs into it, like who is richer in the case just now. And you can easily compute a function if you have all the inputs, but none of the parties is willing to publish their input. And the nice thing about the secure multi-party computation is that there are protocols that actually ensure that you can do this for arbitrary functions that you are able to compute in somewhat remotely reasonable amount of time. Basically, if you don't have enough time to break random crypto by brute force, then you also, or if your algorithm takes less time than that, you can compute it. And you can even extend that to arbitrarily many parties, like a 10-party protocol. And if you want to look into that, though, I think this might get to a point where it's too difficult. The keyword would be YAOS garbled circuits. Now, what is another application that we could use it for? I just said it is very secure. How about elections? We have 80 million people, and they all have one party that they want to vote for, and they all just care about the end result and not who voted how. Well, you could do this, but this really is the sledgehammer approach, and it is quite inefficient. But there are actually more efficient protocols. And this is basically a current research topic, how you can do elections in a way that is secure. This starts out by having three different kinds of elections. The first ones are paper-based elections. They are like the elections you're doing now. You go to the polling station, you get some papers, and there is minor difference in how you cast your vote. Like, for instance, you get a stamp and you have two papers and there is a hole in the upper one and you put your stamp so that both are marked in the same spot. And then you get some kinds of proof that hopefully allow you, on the one hand, to demonstrate if the election was rigged. On the other hand, that they are still in a way that preserves the privacy of the vote. Okay. And the problem with those is it's pretty limited what you do, and most of those approaches do have severe problems, but if you want to look into it, punch scan might not be the most terrible point to start at, which is one of the examples I mentioned below. The second kind of schemes is present schemes, which is basically you go to the polling station similar to what you apparently do in the US, and there are some kind of machines. And I actually call them machines here on purpose and not computers, because if you do it right, they are hopefully just machines and not computers that can execute chess. And with those, they were set up by the voting authority. And so they are not really trustworthy in many regards. So the schemes are basically revolving around how can they produce, how can they give you some kind of receipt that does not allow you to prove to anything else how you voted, because then someone could kidnap your hamster and say, vote for, let's say, Donald Trump, and otherwise I kill your hamster, and we don't want this. So you should not be able to prove how you have been voting. This is where currently there are some schemes that are relatively close to being reasonably usable, but it's still not there yet. So this is an open research topic. And the third one is online schemes, where you just use your own computer and you have all the problems with someone looking over your shoulder while you are voting on your computer, malware on your computer, all that stuff. And yeah, for the third one, there are some schemes I didn't like any of them very much. But for the second one, you might look at bingo voting. And one of the reasons I mentioned that is because it was also developed at KIT, though I'm just a student there, but I know the people who came up with it. So, yeah. And this was basically the main talk. I do have a couple of bonus slides, or you can now ask questions and go much, much deeper in topics that interest you. And yeah, thank you for the attention for now. Everything clear? Or any?
Uh, What about dining cryptographers and multi-party communication?
Could you repeat to me what this was about? I've definitely heard about it, but...
Dining cryptographers is a problem where you have a group of cryptographers sitting in a restaurant and they want to know if the food they have been eating has already been paid for, but they don't want to answer who paid for it, just that it was paid for or not.
Yeah, I remember. Basically, the story was like you had a bunch of cryptographers sitting in a restaurant and they want to pay and someone told them it is already paid and they are like, did the NSA pay for us and they want to threaten us, or was it someone among us? You can, of course, use multi-party computation for that. You simply compute the sum of the inputs, and the people who claim that they don't have paid for it input 0, and the people who claim that they have paid for it input 1. And then you compute the sum, and everyone gets the sum, and you see... If it is 0, then no one of the people who participated claims that he has done it. And you don't need the full sledgehammer of multi-party computations for that. This is where this is more about an encryption scheme, but it's also going beyond what is usually thought about. You do have so-called homomorphic encryption schemes that allow you, given two ciphertexts, to compute a new ciphertext that has whose plain text is in a specified relation to the original plain text. So the simplest case in this one is, given two ciphertexts, I can compute a ciphertext of the sum of the two plain texts. And if everyone encrypts either 0 if he didn't pay, or 1 if he paid, you take all those ciphertexts, you combine them, and you decrypt them, and you can do protocols with at least some encryption schemes where you can do reasonably well shared decryption. Then you decrypt it, and you see what the result is. Any other questions?
With the other talk about the election hacking and election voting machines, you just spoke about one of the options being on machines, not necessarily computers, but I believe it was at DEF CON that all 38 machines that were used for voting in the US were basically flawed in some way or another. All right, go on.
Yeah, those are not cryptographic voting machines. Those machines are... basically, the person who decided to use them is either malicious or insane. There's basically no other way to put it. Real cryptographic voting schemes would give you much better guarantees, and you also would try to not put CPU there, but it were general purpose CPUs. And yeah, if you can't play chess on it. You cannot fake the proofs that a vote was counted correctly, so that's not a problem, but you can easily do things like posting the votes online. Though, in fact, this is actually also the problem with the mention schemes, that they still have kind of trouble to protect your vote, because if you enter the party you want to vote for on the machine learns your vote, and there is no real way around it. And one of the research topics at KRT, for instance, is how they are trying to see if they can build a machine where all the logic parts and the memory and the storage parts are separated in physical ways such that this becomes less plausible. But as I said, this is really current research. The paper that they are currently working on the Platine, so this is not even published.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? Someone interested in giving the broken commitment scheme a try? Yeah, I see a hand there. Yeah, so let's see that. Okay, you remember the original scheme there, just Alice threw the coin. So the first line is exactly like just like in the previous scheme. And the difference is now that before Alice opens her commitment, Bob just sends a commitment instead of the result, and he opens the commitment after Alice opens her commitment, and then they still compute the XOR. Does someone see an attack on this? Let's start like this. It's pretty obvious when you see it in the sense that you would say, but Alice will notice that. There's a way to also fix that Alice notices it, but for the start, do something where you would say, normally Alice would notice that Bob was cheating. Any ideas? Well, let's start with that. At this after the first line, Bob knows a commitment. He doesn't know on what, but he knows this is a commitment on something. And he knows... Yes, he doesn't know what Alice committed to, but he knows it is a commitment. And he knows it is a commitment to something. And he also knows that this commitment will be in a relation to the end result, namely the XOR relation. I think you're even thinking too complicated. Let's get a little bit further with it. Let's give you the hint that, say, Bob wins if the end result is zero. Now, in what relation does Bob's input have to be to Alice's input in order to get zero? It has to be the same. So what can we do? We know a commitment for something. Yes, this is indeed the answer. Bob can simply send the commitment back. He doesn't know what, but he knows that the XOR will be zero. And you could say, well, but we can fix that. We simply check whether it's the same commitment. There you get into some kind of problem because several commitment schemes have another feature, and in many cases it is a feature, called that you can mask a commitment. This means you create a new commitment that is looking indistinguishable from a previous commitment, from a random commitment, but it will be a commitment on the same. And once you know the opening information for the first commitment, you can compute the opening information for your second commitment. And there is nothing you can do about it. Hash commitments are, I believe, not vulnerable to this masking, but the Patterson commitments I mentioned are actually vulnerable to this. And they even allow to... compute the negated commitment to them. Okay, so I think we are now at the end of time, or are we? Okay, so yeah, thank you very much again for your attention.